Dr. Prakash or Mr. Prakash, I would like to quickly introduce him. I met him when the Karnataka Land Right Amendment Act 2020 was going to be brought in through the ordinance route. All the people in Karnataka were actively consolidating, and sir was in multiple webinars, and that's how I got an introduction to him. A movement called Namura Bhumi Namagirali was launched, and then he was also an active participant because of, he is the former chairman Karnataka Agri Commission and Agriculture Commission, Price Commission, I'm very sorry. Yes, Prices Commission. And after the launch of after many protests, I think in Karnataka, there was a consolidation of workers, Dalits and Dalit movements, worker movements, and the farmers, much before the national the protests began or came into the media. And now that the farmers' protest is mainstream, from what I know, sir has been traveling extensively in and around inside Karnataka, doing multiple workshops, sharing the work he has done. And what we need to be asking, what the farmers need to be demanding, the legal right to MSP. And today, the topic we've chosen is a progressive state like Karnataka. Why is the agrarian crisis? And I would like him to share his views. And as usual, questions later, and I will help in moderating if required. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thanks, Rajini, and all our new friends. Okay, let me caution you. I am a retired professor of agricultural economics. I may burden you with the facts and figures. That's my limitations. If you feel that too much of the technical jargon, too much of the facts and figure, you know, kindly, my apology in advance. Let me place before you what a strange asymmetry, dichotomy, contradiction, whatever you call, at a much macro level, pertaining to the agriculture of a country like India. Then let's get, if you could understand that contradiction, dichotomy, little bit, if you got nothing to understand, but probably we didn't have sufficient focus on that contradiction. What is that? The recent production at a macro India level, I think food production is much more than 285 million tons to be precisely. Sorry, 296 million tons. Our horticulture production is 300 plus million tons. 187 million tons of milk, sugar, whatnot, abundance. A state like Karnataka too fared extremely well during, the figure is during the COVID time, you know. Our chief minister has just mentioned, presented the budget, and in budget he has made it very clear the progress agriculture sector has made during COVID. 140 lakh tons of food production. Agriculture marked a positive growth during COVID. Then the COVID-induced lockdown crippled the economy. I think probably the nation's the growth of the GDP is -2 or -3. The agriculture performed extremely well, 3.4% growth rate at the macro level. In Karnataka, it is 6.2% growth, whereas the economy growth is -2.6%. So why this? If that is the case, you know, a sector could perform very well even during the lockdown. Tripled COVID-induced lockdown period, then why this farmers' problem, agrarian crisis, migration, suicide, whatnot? So something is going terribly wrong for people who involved in this sector. So it is a precisely question of a sector doing well, growth of a sector, and welfare and well-being of the people who involved in the sector, that's a farmer. That's something intriguing for people like me, and we are not focused. Why the farmers who said when the sector is performing extremely well, if not performing well? So if you could understand that dichotomy at the macro level, a sector doing well, then the farmers are extremely hardship in terms of income, in terms of stability of the every front, you know, leading to a crisis. Let us get into the Karnataka. Karnataka has been in forefront in various, introducing the various policies, various programs pertaining to the agriculture sector. Let us start with the land reform, for which, you know, the amendment has been introduced much earlier than what happened to at the national level. I think we, Karnataka, along with the West Bengal and few other states have been climbing as we are in the forefront in introducing the progressive land reforms, 1974 Land Reforms Act. Our act is definitely a much more progressive than any state in which are introduced in the arena of the agrarian relationship. Followed by that, you know, I think probably Karnataka is the first state to introduce an agriculture policy at the state level, 1996. When the national level agriculture policy came first time into existence during 2001 and Karnataka introduced 1996 itself. Karnataka is probably first state to introduce a separate Krishi budget and first to introduce IT, BT, and of course, my own commission. I think the Karnataka is the first state to have a separate agriculture commission at the state level. This is in the arena of the agriculture and the agriculture sector as a whole. We too are in the forefront in introducing the progressive reforms in the political arena also. I think probably we are the first state to introduce the progressive, along with the land reforms, a preferential treatment, OBC reservation is, I think, first state to have at the state level, Avanuru Commission. Followed by that, in a massive democratic decentralization, panchayat system during the first ever Janata period, you know, under the Hegde period, we were the first to introduce the progressive reforms in the decentralized governance system also. First to give the 50% reservation for women in our system. And all these things are supposed to manifest that in the areas related to politics and social sectors, you know, especially that defines the agriculture and rural sectors, we are much more progress. Then why that crisis? Why that farmer suicide? Karnataka too has got the dubious record of being either in the first or second. We are competing with the Maharashtra in terms of the number of suicide per in a agriculture season. We are ourselves, Maharashtra, Telangana, and Andhra, we are in the forefront. Most of the time, we are in the first in agrarian crisis, farmer suicide. So nearly 20 lakh hectares are uncultivated. Migration is rampant in the state like Karnataka. Why is this happening? So probably, if I am permitted to over-generalize, if not trivialize, you know, socio-political forwardness, economic backwardness, you know, there's a mismatch. Our agriculture, the strange reason best known to any policymaker in state, you know, we are lagging behind in terms of productivity. The irrigation, you know, development is comparatively lower at even the All India level. With the All India level, the irrigation, you know, is and around 40% of the grass area. Ours, we could not cross more than 36%. Next to Rajasthan, the largest area under dryland, rain-fed condition is in Karnataka. Though we have the many river basins, you know, we could not cross. As a result, you know, our productivity level, long back, you know, it has violated the stagnation in the agriculture productivity. So our Agriculture Price Commission has made it very clear. If you just consider the income from agriculture alone, it is an official report of the Agriculture Price Commission. If you just consider the income from agriculture alone, 70% of the Karnataka farmers, we are having 78 lakh farm population, farm families in Karnataka, farm families, 70% are below poverty line. If you just consider, because that's not the case because they have the non-farm source of income. So this mismatch, you know, on one hand, that may be very common, you know, that even at an individual level also, you are progressive in terms of the social, you are in the socially better level and your pocket is empty, then you cannot keep your belly filled, you know, with the empty pocket. You know, either you are more vulnerable rather than the poor. Poor never feel the insult of the poverty because hunger, because it is something in rule for them, but it's something, you know, somebody's well-being. If you just look at the socio-cultural background of the farm population also, I think nowhere in India, the Brahmins being in farming, nearly 8 to 9% of the total farm holding is by the Brahmin. I think especially in the Karavali and Malnad, coastal regions, you know, they are in the predominant. So being in the socio-culturally forward, but continuous economic crisis because of the reason best known to our policymaker, I think we are in the continued perpetual crisis. And above all, there are 4 or 5 strong reasons for our agriculture being backward in spite of a overall progress in the agriculture sectors in the elsewhere in the country. Again, the growth itself is not an indicator of the development and development, let alone being the sustainable development. Growth can never be having a qualitative dimension of well-being of the people. We produce more and we don't get it. One of the reasons is my price commission. You produce more and you don't get a better return, better price. That's the reason. Well, that's one of the reasons. So as I said, we have introduced the land reforms much earlier than any state. But land reforms has not taken the logical conclusions. So you have given the ownership to the tiller. The ownership to the tiller is the most progressive slogan during the Congress-led government in 1974. But ownership is given. But what is happening? Followed by that ownership, you know, we need to take care of a development, sustainable development. Farmers welfare has not taken care. Ownership. The land reforms is also needed. I think ours is a progress in terms of redistribution of the land among the Dalits, among the landless people. But the ceiling limit had made over the year our agriculture holding become smaller and smaller and smaller. I think 70% of the holdings are less than uneconomic holding. 72% of holding is uneconomic holding. Then hardly 30% gets the water. And even uneconomic holding is fragmented because of the proper trade among all the heads. So I think in the southern state, even the small holding is not a one consolidated holding. It is spread into 4 or 5 the fragmentations. You can imagine, you know, a dry land holding, small holding, uneconomic holding. That may be the reason for, I can say that, the land reform, though it's a progressive one, I am a socialist by my ideological orientation is towards that one. But, you know, it has not taken logical conclusion. What would have been the logical conclusion? Land reforms, consolidation, aggregation. The cooperative farming is the strongest component of our 1974 land reform. It's totally forgotten. Now there's no question of a cooperative agriculture because, you know, we have brought the serious change to the amendment to the land. But I think what I'm to say, you know, is reforms not taking the logical conclusion, half achieved reforms also lead to something, you know, a problem in the agriculture sectors. And followed by that, we are having the diverse agroclimatic condition compared to any state. Extreme highest rainfall to the coastal, to the hilly, to the Malna, to the driest regions. And transition is everything is you can have. I think we are having the 10 diverse agroclimatic conditions. See, diversity, you know, is not perfectly amenable to the Green Dwarf technology. Let me put it the other way. The Green Dwarf technology is for monocropping, irrigation, tractorization, but the diverse systems is not permitted to that one. The inability of the technological system, Green Dwarf model, to comprehend the diverse nature of the agriculture sector is one of the reason, maybe the probable reason. You know, we have given more, so perpetuation of the green revolution is also much lower in terms of, you know, high yielding varieties, in terms of the irrigation, in terms of the mechanization is much lower. I think the type of the developmental model to present the green revolution model may not be best suited for a diverse state like Karnataka. As a result, we are lacking there. And also, the diverse agriculture farmers' background, you know, I don't think so. You have, as I said, you know, Brahmins are also upper caste to the middle order dominant caste like Wakaligas and Lingayats. Followed by that, you know, because of distributions, nearly 30% of the land holding is within the SC, within the scheduled caste, within the OBC, within the minorities in a large scale, you know, Jains, Christians, Muslims are in the large scale, you know. Followed by that, in at other end, you will have the Brahmins 9%. 30% is with the Veerashaiva Lingayats. They are the upper caste. This caste configuration may not best suited to manage the land, which becoming uneconomical. And that also partly explains why the nearly 20% of the holding is kept fallow in a state like Karnataka. 21 lakh hectares is kept fallow, uncultivated. So all these have complicated and your inability to understand in terms of mere technological parameters. If you just look at it, our productivity is low, irrigation is less. It won't explain why the agriculture in the state like in Karnataka is lagging behind. And above all, we are having the serious agroecological crisis also. The very fact, you know, the farmers who started from the old from the Hyderabad, Karnataka region, in the backward region, because of a particular pest, an attack to the two red gram. There's a pod borer, Heliotis armigera, and for which, you know, Monsanto and others have started coming out with the resistant varieties. And it started from there because of the failure of the crop due to pest and diseases. And many regions have the pest and diseases. Nearly 70%, 60 to 70% of the agriculture land, you know, is having the serious soil erosion, salinity. So all this ecological imbalance, you know, is also leading to severe over-exploitation on the other hand, because we don't have the command irrigation. Obviously, the private controlled bore well irrigation, you know, has created a problem. 100 out of the 175 taluks are declared as a dark. You cannot get into the. So all this explain, you know, why agriculture, you know, ecological crisis is the root cause behind the agriculture crisis. Ecological crisis followed by agriculture crisis has given the cultural crisis. It is precisely why the farmer's suicide takes place. You know, the farm agriculture is a cultural crisis is very much there in, you know, socio-cultural problem. Farmer sons, you know, they don't get many of the upper caste farmers, you know, their children cannot get the matching bread at all. So it's a serious problem. Farmers organization have put a one demand saying that, you know, let our children, you know, who stays in agriculture get a matching girls for the marriage. It's a serious culture, the cultural problem. So all this probably might explain why the state like progressive state like Karnataka is getting into the problem of agriculture and seriously caught with the agrarian crisis. The crisis has got a very tangible, clear manifestation in terms of the suicide. I think suicide in the recent year has crossed 1,000 per year. I think that I don't get into that much. So let us get into the current problem. So under this background, one has to view why Karnataka farmers are also in the agitative part. Probably Karnataka is also first state to get into the agriculture, agrarian agitation, agriculture, the farm agitation compared to any other state. We have the reason. It is this government of Karnataka, headed by the BJP government, introduced the radical change, virtually dismantling the very essence of the Land Reforms Act much earlier than what happened at the central level. In the month of May itself, you know, when the whole country is seriously crippled, you know, lockdown was in the at its peak, you know, we have brought in amendment through the amendment route to say that, you know, to help the farmer during the COVID. Why the APMC amendment brought the amendment to the our, I think our APMC system is also much more progress than relatively, I'm telling, to the, any other state. So our APMCs have introduced, you know, the online trading, e-trading, Our online trading, e-trading system is hailed as one of the model to the in Niti Aayog, though it is under the Congress government, it introduced during Siddaramaiah government, and the Niti Aayog recognized and said it was progressive in terms of, you know, introducing the modern information technology. In spite, you know, a serious amendment has been brought to the APMC. Very structure of the APMC has been dismantled. It's totally crippled much earlier than the center introduced. Followed by that, our progressive land reform is virtually made non-functional in terms of its progressive element. What it is progressive element? An equity dimension, you know, an equitable, the very essence of the land reforms. In the land reforms is hailed as the mother of all reforms. It's a commitment of the Gandhiji. I think probably civil disobedience started from the land related issues. Say that, you know, land should not be concentrated in the hands of few, especially Jamindar. It should be given to the tiller. So the equity dimension is very much conspicuous. They have brought a serious amendment to our land reforms. As a result, anyone can buy land with the money. How much land one can buy? 108 acres of land can be bought by anybody in the progressive state as Karnataka. So side by side, our APMC is totally made defunct. It is limited to its jurisdiction to the physical boundary. That's why to say the APMC Act amendment of the center also. We have made it much earlier than. I think the Center Act came into picture in the month of June, and it became functional during November. But in the May itself, you know, we have brought it. As a result of which, you know, Karnataka also has got a long history of the peasant struggle. The farmers' movement is in Karnataka is also much more progressive compared to any other movement elsewhere. It's led by the Karnataka Rajya Rais Sangha, led by a veteran socialist progressive thinker, Professor M.D. Nanjundaswamy. So I think our Green Brigade is very, though it is split and become weak over the years, but they could realize the danger of the land reforms, and we got into the agitation in the month of September itself. I think in the month of September, Rajini and other might have visited. So there's a during the time of the COVID, I think it is assembling of more than 100 people is severely restricted. A massive protest demonstration meeting in the Bengaluru, the day, you know, in which the assembly is about to ratify the amendment, is a massive. I think the leader across India, Yogendra Yadav, All India Kisan Sangat's leader, and many others have participated. I think we are in the forefront of to mark the protest compared to the others elsewhere, because, you know, the introduction has brought up. What is the uniqueness of our protest? The Karnataka farmers' organizations are opposing, or rather, they are looking at the issues of agrarian relationship rather than the agriculture. Let me define what the agrarian issues. Agrarian relationship pertains to the type of the land reform, right, of the ownership. Agrarian relationship also, I think somebody with the left and communist background could understand what's the difference between the agriculture and the agrarian relationship. So it's also a question of the ownership. It's also a question of the agricultural laborers. Even the women issue also become very prominent. You know, Rajini mentioned Namur Bhumi Namagirli Abhiyana. That's it. Which also during the Women's Day, you know, said the women issue, who should own the land? Is it only men or women? So all this put together, you know, I think the Karnataka farmer raised not merely the issue pertaining to the agriculture, making the farming remunerative is not the mere issue here. The who should own the land. So that's why, you know, in Karnataka, along with the farmers, the Dalit movement also have joined hands, because, you know, the distribution of the land is not yet completed. Among the Dalits, among the landless laborers, among the agriculture workers, not yet complete. And now you have destroyed the land reforms, the very essence of the land reforms act. So there is also more worried there as much as the farmers. They also joined. There is also workers' issue also. In the meantime, along with the APMC and also land reforms, amendment is also brought to our labor laws to see that, you know, labor's freedom is curtailed. And the APMC's also is a place where, you know, the casual labor, nearly 2 to 3 lakh labor are working under the APMC system. You know, they'll become the jobless. As a result, the workers too has joined. So Karnataka farm struggle is led by a unique combination of farmers, Dalits, and workers. So it's called as the Aikya Horata. It's a combined struggle. It started in the September 21st itself. I think the followed by that, you know, you will have the struggle elsewhere. And also in the month of November, you could see a massive demonstration in the Delhi, the borders of the major avenues. So in that respect, Karnataka is also in the forefront.
Sir, I would just like to interrupt here. If you can share both the successes, both in the September movement when you went and met Chief Minister, because you had got success in the movement end of September during the session. And the first time, which is the monsoon session, post-COVID session, you actually were successful in stopping a few of the amendments. And then again in December, you were able to reach some success. Is that true? Would you like to share?
Success is very partial. One could say that, you know, as a result of our struggle during September, that session started on 21st September, precisely to ratify the amendment. All these were brought as to, just like by the government of India, it's brought through the amendment route. Without any discussion, they placed before the assembly. Then assembly is supposed to ratify. Because of the strong resentment, agitation, and September 28th, we had a massive Karnataka ban. As a result of all these things, you know, we could stall the ratification of the amendment during the September session. And in the upper house, you know, where the majority is occupied by the opponents, you know, Congress or JDS. So we could halt at least to the extent possible during the September session. Then again, when it's joined August, our so-called son of the farmers, H.T. Devegowda, suddenly backtracked and supported indirectly to the amendment. As a result, you know, amendment has been passed. But still, because of our continuous resistance, demonstration, and giravo, we could convince the governor not to sign for some time. Again, during that session, you know, we could halt. At least the governor has given a categorical assertion to see that, you know, we'll take it to the once again. Though governor had a limited option, and the governor under the current dispensation, I didn't expect anything. But again, we could see that we could halt that fund. But now, both amendments have been ratified. They have been implemented. And the fact says that, you know, the land transaction, land buying of the land from the farming taking place in a very large scale, no doubt. We had to see that one. But the most dangerous sign, you know, at the national level, three acts by the government of India have been put under hold for some time, for 18 months. But in Karnataka, it has been implemented. As a result of the amendment to the APMC, the transaction selling within the APMC has reduced drastically to the extent of 25 to 70% when compared to the last year. So 70% of the transaction has been cut. So very soon we can expect APMC to become the defunct, and APMC too are having the huge land in a Tashil, you know, tied four cities, you know, the way the APMC is at taluka levels. So once, you know, APMC become defunct, no more functional, then obviously you have the opportunity to see that they privatize those APMC yard structures. That's most important for us. And it's happening already. So I think at the national level, farmers could have some an element of success to the extent possible, you know, which were withheld for 18 months. And anytime government is ready to see that, you know, they withheld. But at the state level, we have lost the battle, I can say that. The reasons are so little obvious. I think that's how the social configuration of the peasant is very important. Till recently, the farmers, the struggle is led by farmers. I think at the national level, in my understanding of the farmers' social configuration is right. It is taken over by the two most prominent communities which were in the forefront of the Green Revolution. The Sikhs and Jats are in the forefront of the struggle at the Delhi. It's very important, the social configuration. On the other hand, the social group or the caste group, you know, which are controlling the farm lands in Karnataka, most of them still are with the BJP. The Lingayats are the powerful social background for the BJP, followed by the Brahmins, both are with the BJP. And the Wakaligas and the JDS, because of the ambiguous stand of the JDS, you know, still they don't know. So what I'm trying to say here, you know, in the recent budget, our Yediyurappa, in the shrewdest possible way, could recognize caste within the farmers. You are not the farmer, you are Lingayats. You are not the farmer, you are Wakaligas, you are Brahmins. So in the shrewdest possible way, by articulating the caste feelings among the peasantry, he formed a separate board for Lingayats. So Lingayat boards, Lingayat caste, a separate boards, Wakaligas, a separate boards, Brahmins, separate board, some amount. So you are the first Lingayats, you are first Brahmins, you are first Wakaligas. Brahmins, Lingayats, together controlling 60-70% of the land holding, you be happy with the farm. So it's easy for the, it's a good old tactics of the BJP to invoke the caste within the peasantry, invoking the class. But I don't think it is going to last forever. Farmers have been slowly recognizing. So what is happening at Delhi? The farmers who enjoyed the maximum benefit of the procurement, maximum benefit of any MSP are not happy. So the farmers in Karnataka, as a farmer, the price commission are asking, give more procurement and give us the more remunerative price. M.S. Swaminathan price was the something, you know, which is the single point program during my tenure as agriculture price comes out, the farmers of Karnataka. Though we have not progressed to the extent possible in procurement and ensuring MSP, but they are looking at the farmers of Punjab, farmers of Haryana, farmers of Madhya Pradesh. But if they are not happy, they are having the huge suspicion on the central government. Then our farmers slowly realize, go, this won't work. We are the farmers first, then our caste affiliation the next. Within the farmers, you know, slowly this class affiliation, we are the farmers, we are the small farmers, we are the poor farmers, we are the brilliant farmers. So it is slowly coming to the forefront, no doubt. The farmers are agitations, you know, led by the progressive left socialist elements, you know, are not going to miss this, the responsibility to invoke the class identity, the invoke them, this they are the farmers first and caste next, and followed by their the class identity, their backwardness, their poverty. If it could succeed, we succeed in the farmer struggle, we succeed in farmer struggle leading into a larger political transformation. Ultimately, we are into the political transformation. You cannot be taken for granted. Farmers cannot be taken for right in terms of their caste, in terms of their religious identity. So I think in that case, you know, Karnataka also may pave the way for something to the entire India, for probably for the entire world. The world is under the crisis in terms of their political formation, you know. What is happening to the democracy, not only in a state like country like India, but what is happening in a country like America? Till recently, what happened in a mature democracy, a person who got elected is not ready to transfer what happened? I think the democracy, I'm not a person to get deep into that. The democracy is too is in a crisis. But here is a case in India could lead, in my opinion, a democracy emanating, a struggle emanating, a resistance emanating from the ground-trodden, grassroots farmers and the rural level could pave the way for a better political transformation. I'm not the person to say that one. There's the element of political transformation to make the ruling dispensation to see that real problem is not the caste and the religion. Real problem is the class. Real problem is the peasant. Real problem is the rural economy. I think we can give the way for the rest of the India. But last but not least, among all the, no, we don't want the farm laws. We don't want the amendment to APMC. We don't want the amendment to, I think the one thing become extremely conspicuous and clear. That was precisely, I think I had a modest experience of being part of that. The price related issues becoming the forefront. Till recently, farmers didn't know what they want. Now, in addition to the what they don't want, you know, farmers, I was in a later event saying, you know, you are telling we don't want globalization. You are telling you don't want the biotechnology. You are telling you don't want the multinational, but you don't know what you want. Here is a case among Indian peasantry and also the Karnataka farmers to say, we want a remunerative price. We want a price for our produce, which is remunerative as recommended by noted Senator M.S. Swaminathan. We want a guaranteed remunerative price through the legal recourse. I think the legal protection to a remunerative price discovery become much more prominent. That, you know, we have been taking. We had a technical session to the farmers' organization of Karnataka recently to say what is the different dimensions of the legal status to MSP, followed by the various necessary conditions. One of the necessary conditions is to strengthen the government intervention, strengthen the government control, government regulation. Precisely, it is a case for strengthening the APMCs, not diluting the APMCs. As the movement becomes very strong here to see that our APMCs should be strengthened to procure more, to protect the interest of farmers, make the APMCs much more competitive in terms of their performance, make it pro-farmer, making much more transparent, and see that a remunerative price discovery could take place in MSP, for which the legal recourse is a must. So all these are coming to the forefront. This is the positive outcome of the agrarian struggle in Karnataka. And I think it has given a wonderful opportunity for a people like me. I'm a technocrat. I'm a retired professor. I'm a scientist. Otherwise, you know, COVID would have been much more unbearable to be in the home, being any work, any assignment, any job, any challenge for me. There are many, many people like me are in the forefront. You can call this the policy maker, you can call them the technocrat, you can call it the scientist, you can call it whatever name you call. We are with the farmers movement in Karnataka today. So let me stop at this point. I think I have covered most of the things what I'm supposed to say. My purpose is to invoke some interest, make them confused. That's what my present throughout my life. If you are, I think you have some, if you could create some element of interest in your mind and create more confusion, it will give more scope for you to take it forward, ask me more questions. I think I have tried my level best to do justice. In spite, the issue is, you know, why a progressive state like Karnataka is experiencing the agrarian crisis and also is in the forefront of farmer struggle. The issue, the topic before us definitely needs more focus and your attention. If I fail in drawing your attention, I fail in doing the justice. Precisely is my inability, not the topic before us. Definitely, you have the very opportunity to take it forward. Thanks, Rajini, and all my friends, this opportunity. Let me stop here. And if you have the option, any possibility to have some clarification and adding more, not merely clarification, correcting me, interacting with your experience, your immense background, I'll be extremely grateful. Thanks for this opportunity. Let me see any queries.
Yes, sir. I will start taking questions. I think we already have one. The people in the webinar are all known to the organizers. So if you wish, you can unmute and ask yourself. I will meanwhile ask Mr. Soumya Gupta. Is that Mr. or Miss? I'm so sorry. Soumya's question was that I didn't know 8 to 9% of Brahmins are in farming. Is that also with those who own land?
One Brahmins community called the Havyaks, especially they are in the large number in coastal and Malnadu, the Western Ghats regions, you know. Yeah, it's 8 to 9% of the land holding is owned by the farmers. There's no question of the tenancy. It's the ownership. I'm pertinent to the ownership.
Yeah. Anyone else wish to ask? Otherwise, I would request Bobbyji to give me the questions from Facebook or other platforms. You can also use, I think you can unmute yourself. If you're not, you can raise your hand. Thank you, sir. That was very informative. I had comments in the chat. I was quickly typing in what you were saying because, like you said, it's a little heavy on facts and data. I've given all the notes to everyone. So Soumya again asks, I'm very grateful because in Madhya Pradesh, I teach in central school and did not know farmers' movement in South India, especially Karnataka. Forgive me for my ignorance, but the learning process has been very good for me. May I ask if contract farming could be good?
There's a lot of problem in contract farming. The contract farming is an asymmetry. It is a contract between a powerful company versus a poor farmer, individual farmer. So, one of the correction, if at all you agree for that, it should be between a company and a group of farmers organization. Number two, contract farming is a very intensive farming system. You get into the contract farming not to produce food, not to produce oils, you produce extremely high valued export oriented crop. Obviously, you use lot of chemicals, lot of pesticides, lot over exploited the water. So, environmental sustainability is something extremely critical in contract farming. Third, it may tamper with the agrarian relationship. What would happen? Because in the present context, farmers after some time may lose the land. That's what the apprehension. A company may take over the land in the course of time. Above all, in the present context, the contract farming is under the purview of the central law, not the state law. We don't know what would happen if the state loses the control. This is the larger question with regard to the contract farming. Rather than the contract farming, an element of aggregation, you call it, it's a modern day buzzword, aggregation. Farmers should come farming. It may be cooperative farming, it is a farmers group, it is a collective farming. Farmers come forward to produce, farmers come forward to manage the natural resources, water, borewell irrigation, manage the mechanization instead of the a single farmer cannot buy a tractor, combiner, harvest rather than. And you can have a cooperative machine use system. And above all, a collective aggregation is a must to capture the market. That's what very much missing. Individually, farmers is weak. Farmers are weak in their bargaining capacity. So they are the price taker, not the price maker. So in order to put an element of control over the price, at the time of price discovery, a collective bargaining is very important. That's why in the farmers in the coastal districts are also forefront in much earlier than anyone think of a collective cooperative marketing. Our CAMCO, one of the successful cooperative marketing systems, is very much in the coastal districts, again led by the Brahmins, and upper caste Brahmins, and also in the coastal districts. So I'm not bringing the caste element again and again, but what I'm trying to say here, you know, the cooperative experiment is very conspicuous in the arachnid farming. So that is very important here. So all these are very much missing in the present law and present act. And the contract farming has not given rise to a collective bargaining power. That is very much something one has to look at very cautiously.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. So, Mr. Praveen Srivatsuji asks, does the farmers' agitation, do you think, will in Karnataka will have any impact on the elections in upcoming in Tamil Nadu or Kerala?
It's a question for me.
Yes, sir. Will it have an impact?
Absolutely. When? That's what I'm telling. So, you are trying your level best to mask the peasantry identity among these people. So, once they waken up, say that, you know, we are the farmers first. So you cannot address the farmers. The farmers is not a homogeneous group. The community identity of the farmers. When the farmers, Wakaliga farmers recognize, most of the regional parties are the peasantry-led regional parties. No, our JDS is which caste is the backbone of the Janata Dalis. It is Wakaligas. Unfortunately, they are not in the position to articulate their the peasantry identity. So when the community get woken up and being identified as their peasantry related issues, agrarian issues, definitely it will have the huge impact on the forthcoming election and the election in the future also. I think the present political dispersion led by BJP, both at center and at the state, are not at all in a position to address farmers as farmers. They are not in a position to address the agrarian issues. They are not in a position to address the issues pertaining to the Indian agriculture. They can look at best, you know, their religion and the caste. Again, I'm repeating this one. So I think it will. They cannot go to Punjab because, you know, in Punjab, it is the Sikh community has woken up. The Jat have made it, led by Tika. I said, we are ready to extend the struggle till October 2nd. This is the threat for the center. Center is definitely worried about the farmers' movement. But same thing could happen here in Karnataka, here in South India, here in Tamil Nadu, elsewhere. You know, definitely it will have a huge impact. We have to see. I think Tamil Nadu farmers is also up in the army. I don't know what is the community configuration, social background of the farmers in Tamil Nadu. If it has got an element of an impact, definitely it will have an impact on the election result also. You cannot isolate the election to your conventional approach to the vote bank politics may not work in the future. That's my firm belief. And it is a challenge before the present organizations and the farmers leaders also to see that the agrarian issues backed by their community background, social background, should not be sidelined at the time of election. It's a challenge for those people also. I don't know what would happen to the opposition party also. Definitely, peasantry issue is as good as the ruling dispersion would do all its level best. You know, it have already started to collect the huge donation invoking the Ram Mandir. I think Ram Mandir issue is totally sidelined because of the farmers' issues. They have tried their level best. They can make all their attempt to see that to invoke the other identity rather than the real farmers' identity. What action they are going to succeed, we have to watch in the forthcoming election.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Zafar, I think he's from West Bengal and says, thank you for connecting the dots, especially ecology to agriculture to the caste economic divide. Can you please share if women's rights and women's agency in farming is recognized? Because in West Bengal, we rarely see women, urban or rural, to have same land rights. Though West Bengal has many positive things on gender, but land rights is not something that we are proud, that is they are proud of.
At least an attempt is going on in state like Karnataka. I don't know in other part. So we began with our struggle involving three communities, three groups, farmers, Dalits and workers. In recent days, you know, women and the youths also have joined. So you could see our emblem, you know, to see our logo, to three hands holding barbed wire together to protect our system. So now three hands become the five hands. Women issues also become, obviously, you know, it is going to, I think this is the beauty of the struggle that emanating from the grassroots, from the people. No longer you can sideline the women issues. And in the recent December, the dharanas, you know, there is one or two women organization have become very prominent. Slowly, the farm women issue also becoming very important. It can never be men-led. It can never be rich farmers-led. It can never be upper caste farmers-led. It can never be commercial farmers-led. So all these dimensions are coming to the forefront, and it is an opportunity, it is a challenge, it is an excellent time for all of us who are having an affiliation to this progressive, socialist, left ideology. I think those people are becoming very prominent. People like Yogendra Yadav has become very active in spite of his ill health. He has toured throughout Karnataka, raised the issue of the legal status of farmers. I think he could understand. It's a time, it's a chance, it's an opportunity for all of us. I think people will make use of this opportunity.
Thank you, sir. One more question. It's come from Facebook, Garima Patelji. Karnataka has a lot of corporations. I would assume she means private companies. Do you think there is industry influence on government's policy decisions?
In Karnataka?
Yes, yes. Karnataka.
The first land reforms amendment brought with the pressure from the industry. So see that they can purchase the land, they can easy transaction of the land, and in a shortest possible way, the government said, no, we don't allow the irrigation land to be taken away by the corporate, but they have stood, in a shortest way, they excluded the borewell irrigation. Therefore, land in and around Bangalore, whole world, corporate world for the land around, in and around Bangalore. In and around Bangalore is not the command irrigation, in and around is the borewell irrigation. That means the borewell irrigation is exempted from the takeover by the corporate body. They don't want to take over land by the somewhere else in the Tungabhadra area, Mandya area. They want land in and around Bangalore. So Bangalore around area is easy for grabbed by the corporate body. I think they are very much before the very fact that borewell is not considered as the irrigated land, irrigation one. So borewell irrigated land can be easily procured by the corporate, the industrial purpose is the very fact that the huge influence of the corporate body. Do you expect in a state like Karnataka, in a city like Bangalore, corporate body to keep quiet? They are very much behind the amendment for Karnataka Land Reforms Act as well as APMC Amendment Act.
Sorry. Yeah, thank you, sir. So I think I'd also just shared that the Davos Summit, which our government attended last year pre-COVID, they had promised that there will be ease of land acquisition for industries, and they had to stick to that promise. And
absolutely no, it is, yeah. It's the terminology of the World Bank and IMF that the land market is very, very restricted, so we cannot buy land just like any other commodity. Precisely, the land reforms opposing land being a commodity to be traded just like any other commodity. It is a free gift of the nature by definition as a natural resource. It's not an input. It is
neither produced nor created by human beings. So we don't have right. That's why, you know, land agrarian relationship across the world are very, very serious to see that land should not be traded. Land should be under the control of the state. That's what one would say. But in the, under the land reforms, that land is owned by the those who till the land. It's not concentrated. There is no question of the huge land in the hand, huge land in the hands of few people. But it is something, you know, which is not compatible with the neoliberal policies. The globalization says that, you know, economic liberalism says that why cannot land to be transferred? To buy land, I have to go through huge procedural thing, you know. Earlier then, you know, non-agriculturists cannot buy land in Karnataka. A person with the income of more than 25 lakh cannot buy the land in Karnataka. But now, anybody with the Aadhaar can buy land up to 108 acres. Who can buy land? Who is capable of buying land up to 108 acres? Not farmer, not people like you and me would like to get into the farming afresh. But it's only corporate can buy land up to 108 acres. Very fact that your the limit to buy land increased to 108 per family. A corporate party, if you have got a 10 family, 10 into 108 in the 1,000 acre, you can buy in Karnataka, a village can be bought by the corporate. That's my precisely. If I am wrong, I'll be extremely happy. A corporate body will buy not land, it's by village. If possible, by tashil. If my statement may be more exaggeration, there is every reason to say that. Let us see what would happen. So, the land transaction, the world term land transaction, land transaction, land market. It is precisely the world by the IMF, world by the World Bank. It makes very easy now.
Just to play the devil's advocate, sir, Karnataka is full of migrant affluence, has increased because of IT, BT, pharma. So now if I want to switch my career and I want to put my life savings and I want to farm, was there scope in the old amendment, old act, KLRA act?
Old act, you know, that is one of the precise reason given to amend the land. These IT people, and these technocrats are not coming from the Mars or from America. Our survey says 70% of the IT people are having the farm background. There is no, and also they say, you know, agriculture graduate cannot buy the land. It is a false information. The agriculture graduates are from the farm family. Anybody having the farm, agriculture land or farm family, as per the Land Reform Act of 1972, is eligible to buy land. If you are from the farming family, majority of the IT people are from the farming family, no doubt. Number one, now even the IT people getting into the, it's a genuine a technocrat, an IT person getting into the land. It's hard-earned money. Now he or she cannot get the land because you have to compete with the corporate body. You can say, I'm ready to purchase land for 10 lakh rupees per acre. A corporate party will say, because your capacity to buy land up to 5 acres, 10 acres, definitely you will not be in a position to invest for 108 acre land. But I am the corporate body. I have the huge money. Sometimes it is a black money getting turned into the white money. So you cannot compete with me. Even IT person also cannot buy land, let alone farmers buying land for farming. So the worry is here, you know, land is not also getting out of the farmer. Land is also getting out of the agriculture. That is a much more dangerous thing, you know. You buy land, corporate party will buy land. You don't know what for you make use of the land. It is a resort culture. It is for something else other than farming, something else other than the food production, something else than genuine agriculture. You don't know what for you stand for. It definitely adds your strength to your asset position. A corporate body with 1,000 acres of land, your share value will be very high, stability. You have the asset position is very, till today, you know, the asset position is backed by the real estate value. A company is having the 1,000 square feet in Bengaluru. Okay, you have 1,000 square feet. and added to that in the annual transaction. But now a company which is having some dealing with the farming would also have huge backing of the agricultural land.
That's the thing you look at, you know. Anybody would like to invest on, you are having 1,000 acres of land, 10,000 acres of land. This is something, you know, which I could really envisage, I could look at in the days to come in terms of the land transaction in the state like Karnataka.
Thank you, sir. Guru, other hosts, kindly help me if there's any other question from Facebook, if I've missed.
That's all. There is no question.
Okay.
Yeah. Just so, thank you and other comments from the Facebook page as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, sir. Once again for agreeing. It was very last minute. I know your schedule is very busy, and I'm also very happy to say that you kickstarted the Karnataka series on the Satyagraha talks. More of farming issues will be discussed in the coming weeks. We'll be coordinating with you, like yourself, other experts, farmers, farmer leaders, so that their perspective, their issues are also brought in, women farmers. You were kind enough to come today at short notice. So once again, thank you. And I'll continue to look forward to working with you.
Okay, thanks, Prithvi. Thanks for this opportunity. I look forward to continued interactions, discussion, dialogue like this. Good luck for your Satyagraha attempt and my wholehearted appreciation for the initiative. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thanks again.